فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد، إن شاء الله تعالى I will be speaking about حكم الاحتفال بالمولد النبوي. What is the ruling in celebrating the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's birthday? What is the ruling regarding it in the Sharia? And the reason why a topic like this we speak about is because we love the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is because we love him so much alayhi salatu wasalam that we want to know if this action is something that will get us closer to Jannah or is it something that will distance us from the hellfire. It is out of love of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam we speak about this issue. But before I speak about the topic and I delve into it, there is something I have to mention which the ulama refer to as tahriru mahallu niza'. تحرير محل النزاع. And that means, what is the point of discussion? Are we speaking about whether the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he should be loved or not? Is that what we're speaking about? No. Are we speaking about whether salutation should be sent on the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Are we speaking about that? No. What we're talking about on, what we're talking about is Rabi' al-Awwal, the 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal. Can somebody celebrate this day? This is what we're talking about. And when they tell the people that these individuals, they don't like the Salah on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is called in Arabic Al-Hayda al-Mawtinu al-Nizah. It is turning away from the point of discussion. When they say these people do not love the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is again al-hayda an mawtin al-niza'. It's turning away from the point of discussion. What we're speaking about are we allowed to celebrate the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's birthday? And loving the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is aslu min usul al-din. It's a fundamental matters of our religion. We love him more than ourselves. We love him alayhi salatu wasalam more than our own children and our parents. But the question is, are we allowed to celebrate his birthday alayhi salatu wasalam? Is it something that the Sharia legislated or is it not? So this is very important that it's understood. I'm going to start my topic by speaking about tarikh al-ihtifal bil mawlid wa awwal huduthih. The history of how the Mawlid al-Nabawi started and who were the first people who came with it. One thing I want you to all remember, those who say the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's birthday can be celebrated, some scholars have said that, and those who said it is not allowed, both parties agree that this was something that was not done by the three noble generations. The ones who celebrate, the muhtafilin, and the munkirin, those who were celebrating the Prophet's birthday from the ulama, and those who don't celebrate the Prophet's birthday, the issue they all agree upon is, this is not an action that the three noble generation came with. I'll read you some of their statements. Al-Imam Al-Hafidh Al-Sakhawi, rahimahullah, who is the student of Ibn Hajar, and he's from those who believed you can celebrate the Prophet's birthday. Look what he said. He said, عمل المولد الشريف لم ينقل عن أحد من السلف. The celebrating of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's birthday لم ينقل عن أحد من السلف الصالح. It is not been transmitted from any of the noble believers of the three noble generation. في القرون الثلاثة الفاضلة وَإِنَّمَا حَدَثَ بَعْدُ. Rather, this occurred after the three noble generation. Sakhawi is a... He's from those who believe you can celebrate the Prophet's birthday. So the scholars, they say, وَشَهِدَ شَاهِدٌ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا. A person from within them testified to this. I have many other statements, and I'll bring them later, inshaAllah ta'ala. So if they admit and they say, okay, that the Prophet didn't do this, and Abu Bakr didn't do this, and Umar didn't do this, and Uthman and Ali, and the companions didn't do it, nor did the students of the companions do it, nor did the students of the companions do it, nor did the four A'immatul Arba'ah, Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, Al-Imam Malik, Al-Imam Shafi'i, and Imam Ahmed did not do it. None of their students did it. Abu Hanifa's students, Abu Yusuf and Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani, they didn't do it. Imam Malik, rahimahullah, his student Abdullah ibn Wahbin and Ma'al ibn Isa, they didn't do it. Imam Shafi'i, his student Rabi' ibn Sulaiman al-Muradi and Ismail ibn Yahya al-Muzani, they didn't do it. Imam Ahmed's students, none of them did it. So who did it? This is called a point of agreement. Huh? It's agreed upon. So when did it start and who started it? The people who started it are the following. Al-Imam al-Miqrizi, rahimahullah, he has a kitab called Al-Khutat. First volume, page 490. He says, ذِكْرُ الْأَيَّامِ التي كان الخلفاء الفاطميون يتخذونها أعيادا ومواسم تتسع بها أحوال الرعية وتكثر نعمهم. He chaptered in his kitab. This kitab is a history book. It's one volume. He mentions the days in which the خلفاء leaders, the leaders, the خلفاء الفاطميون, they called themselves فاطميون, attributing themselves to فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the scholars of history, like Ibn Kathir and others, have proven that they were not from the lineage of Fatima. They were liars. And they claimed to be from the lineage of Fatima. And inshallah ta'ala, we'll speak about who they were. So we call them the name that they really deserve, which is, they are Ubaydiyun. The Khulafa'ul Ubaydiyun are the ones who started it. Yet they made, within the year, he said, A'yadan, celebrations. Wa mawasima tattasi'a biha ahwaluh. تَتَّسِعُ بِهَا أَحْوَالُ الرَّعِيَّةِ وَتَكْثُرُ نِعَمَهُمْ. Within the year they had celebrations which they would virtue the people by giving them gifts and celebrating. وَكَانَ لِلْخُلَفَاءِ الْفَاطِمِيِّينَ. And Imam al-Miqrizi says, the Fatimiyin, they used to have through the year celebrations, and from those celebrations he said, فِي طُولِ السَّنَةِ أَعْيَادُ وَمَوَاسِمُ وَهِيَ مَوَاسِمُ وَمَوْلِدُ النَّبِي. And the Prophet's celebration was one of them, was the first thing that they would celebrate. Al-Imam Abu al-Abbas Ahmad ibn Ali al-Qalaqshandi, he says in his kitab Subhu al-A'sha, he says Al-Julusu al-Thalith, the third sitting which they used to have the leaders, the Khulafa al-Fatimiyun, was what? Julusuhu fi mawlidi al-Nabi. They used to sit in the Prophet's mawlid, they used to do a gathering. Fi al-Thani ashara, and they used to do this on the 12th of the month of Shahr Rabi' al-Awwal. The Mufti of Diyar al-Misriya sabiqan, he's not a Wahhabi, he's the Mufti of what? He's the Mufti of Diyar al-Misriya. He was the Mufti of Egypt. Al-Sheikh Muhammad al-Muti'i, Hanafi in Madhab, he says, مِمَّا أُحْدِثَ وَكَثُرَ السُّؤَالُ عَنْهُ al-Muwalid. One of the things that have been introduced, and the questions regarding it have become excessive. I mean, we've been asked about this many in many places. فَنَقُولُ, our response is. So there's something that has been introduced, and the question regarding it has become so much. And he says the mawalid, the celebrating the Prophet's birthday. فَنَقُولُ, our response regarding this question is, إِنَّ أَوَّلَ مَنْ أَحْدَثَهَا, the first people who innovated, who brought it, are بالقاهرة in Egypt, are الخلفاء الفاطميون. They are the فاطميون who brought it. وأولهم, the فاطميون, they went through phases. But who was from amongst them the first one who did it from their leaders? المعز لدين الله. He's the one who started it. His name is called المعز لدين الله. You can find this in the Kitab Ahsan al-Kalam, page 44. Sheikh Ali Mahfouz, who's from the Kibar ulama'i Misr. Again, he's not a person who's Wahhabi, as they would say. He said, إِنَّ أَوَّلَ مَنْ أَحْدَثَهَا, the first people who brought celebrating the Prophet's birthday in Egypt are الخلفاء الفاطميون في القرن الرابع. They started this in the 4th century. فَابْتَدَعُوا سِتَّةَ مَوَالِدٍ. Within the year, they made 6 celebrations. المولد النبي, the first one was the Prophet's birthday. ومولد إمام علي بن أبي طالب. ومولد السيدة فاطمة الزهراء. ومولد الحسن والحسين. ومولد الخليفة الحاضر. They will celebrate Ali, Fatima, Hassan, Hussein, رضي الله عنهم جميعا. And even the leader himself, his birthday will be celebrated as well. الشيخ علي محفوظ mentions that in the Kitab الإبداع في مدار الإبتداع, page 251. He went on to say, وَقَدْ إِسْتَمَرَّ الْعَمَلُ بِالْمَوْلِدِ. The Mawlid Fatimiyun started it, and he said it carried on. إِلَى يَوْمِنَا هَذَا, to this day. وَتَوَسَّعَ النَّاسُ فِيهَا, and the people went excessive in it. وَابْتَدَعُوا بِكُلِّ مَا تَهْوَى أَنفُسُهُمْ, and they added onto the Mawlid everything that their mind and their desires pushed them to. وَتُوحِيهِ إِلَيْهِ شَيَاطِينُ الْإِنسِ وَالْجِنِ, and they added into celebrating the Prophet's birthday whatever revelation Shaytan sends on them, they will do it. Now they rap and music is on. وَلَا نِزَاعَ, and Shaykh Ali Mahfouz said, وَلَا نِزَاعَ, there is no debate, فِي أَنَّهَا مِنَ الْبِدَعِ, that it's from the innovation. Who also said that? Al-Ustad Sa'ad al-Sadiq in his kitab Sira' Bain al-Haqq wal-Batil. Al-Shaykh Muhammad ibn Sa'ad ibn Qushayr, he mentions it. Al-Shaykh Muhammad ibn Ibrahim al-Shaykh, Al-Shaykh Abdul Aziz ibn Baz, Al-Shaykh al-Albani, Al-Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestow his never-ending mercy onto all of them. The question here is now, we now know the Fatimiyun are the ones who started it. But who are they? Are they people who are righteous? They are role models, people who should take this ruling from and this good deed? Or are they people who are evil and we should run away from them and their doings? Let's look what Imam Al-Hafidh ibn Kathir said about them in his book Al-Bidayah wa Nihaya. When he speaks about the event of 402, when he's talking about that year, the things that happened, he says, وَكَتَبَ جَمَاعَةٌ, he says, a group of scholars, they wrote, وَالْقُضَاتِ, judges, وَالْأَشْرَافِ وَالْعُدُولِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ وَالْفُقَهَاءِ وَالْمُحَدِّثِينَ, عُلَمَا, فُقَهَا, مُحَدِّثِينَ, أَشْرَافِ, honorable individuals, عُدُول, reliable people, they all wrote, all of them, they wrote, وَشَهِدُوا جَمِيعًا, all of them wrote, البيان. They brought out a bayan. أن الفاطميين, that the فاطميين ملوك مصر, the leaders of Egypt are كفار, فساق, فجار, ملحدون, زنادقة, معطلون, وللإسلام جاحدون, ولمذهب المجوسية والثنوية معتقدون, قد عطلوا الحدود, وأباحوا الفروج, وأحلوا الخمر, وسفكوا الدماء, وسبوا الأنبياء, ولعنوا السلف, ودعوا الربوبية. They said they're كفار, فساق, فجار, ملاحدة, heretics, زنادقة, معطلون للإسلام, they dismantled Islam. ولمذهب المجوسية والثنوية معتقدون, they are idol worshippers and fire worshippers. قد عطلوا الحدود, وأباحوا الفروج, they made zina halal. وأحلوا الخمر, they made خمر halal. وسفكوا الدماء, they spilled blood in Egypt when they came. وسبوا الأنبياء, they insulted the prophets. ولعنوا السلف, they insulted the pious predecessors. ودعوا الربوبية, and they claimed that they are إله. القاضي الباقلاني, the great Ash'ari leader, scholar, Ibn Kathir transmits from him in his Kitab al-Bidayah wa-Nihaya, the 11th volume, page 369. He said about the Fatimiyin, what did he say about them? هم قوم يظهرون الرفض ويبطنون الكفر المحض والله سبحانه وتعالى أعلم. He says they are a people who show the people that they are Rafida. That's what they show. They say we're Rafida. ويبطنون الكفر, but what they have in their hearts is disbelief, he said. Clear-cut disbelief. Ibn Kathir goes on to, now we spoke about the Fatimiyun, who they were. Let's talk about this individual who started it, Al-Mu'izz li-Dinillah from the Fatimiyun. Who is he? As you know, the Fatimiyun, their Khilafah was in Morocco. It got moved from Morocco and it got taken into Egypt, Qahira. And the people who brought it into Qahira, the man who brought it into Qahira was Al-Mu'izz li-Dinillah. He's the one who brought it. When he came to Egypt, he landed first in Al-Iskandariya. And when he landed, the people came to visit them, because they came with their armies and their strength. So he done a khutbah for them. And he said to them that he's going to bring justice for the oppressed. The ones who have been oppressed and have been wronged, he's going to come and bring them their rights. And then what he said to them was, وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ رَحِمَ الْأُمَّةَ بِي. Allah has brought mercy to the people through me. وَهُوَ مَعَ ذَلِكَ Ibn Kathir says, even though he is saying that, مُتَلَبِّسٌ بِالرَّفْضِ ظَاهِرًا وَبَاطِنًا. He has Rafidi belief, externally and internally. And then he goes, وَكَذَلِكَ أَهْلُ دَوْلَتِهِ. And the people of his government, وَأُرْ رَافِضًا. And anyone who obeyed him, and anyone who was given victory to him, وَرَافِضًا. And anyone who loved him, they loved. And anyone who went against them, they killed. And then Ibn Kathir mentions a story of a man. He said, وَقَدْ أَحْضَرَ. One day, المعز لدين الله, he brought a man close. Ibn Kathir says about this man, he was a زاهد, عابد, ورع, ناسك. He was a taqi, Abu Bakr al-Nabulisi, his name was Abu Bakr al-Nabulisi. He was a abid, a worshipper, aesthetic person, God-fearing individual. So المعز لدين الله said to him, بلغني عنك, it reached me regarding you. أنك قلت, that you claim that if I was to have 10 arrows, I would direct 9 arrows towards the Romans, and the 10th arrow I would direct it at what? The Fatimiyin. I heard you said something like that, that you would throw an arrow at us. He responded by saying, ما قلت هذا. I didn't say that. فظن أنه رجع عن قوله. So he thought he came back from his speech and his opinion, and that he's not upon that anymore. He said, but what did you say? Abu Bakr al-Nabulisi said, what I said was, if I was to have 10 arrows, I would direct 9 at you guys. And the 10th one, I would direct it at the Romans. And then Al-Mu'izz li-Dinillah said to him, walima, why? He said, لِأَنَّكُمْ غَيَّرْتُمْ دِينَ الْأُمَّةِ. You've changed the people's religion. وَقَتَلْتُمُ الصَّالِحِينَ. And you have killed the righteous individuals. وَأَطْفَأْتُمْ نُورَ الْإِلَهِيَةِ. You've extinguished the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's religion. وَادَّعَيْتُمْ. And you have claimed مَا لَيْسَ لَكُمْ, that which you don't have no right for. You guys have claimed what isn't yours, meaning rububiyyah. You've claimed. He said, is that the case? Ha. Okay. He said to his guards, grab him. So they grabbed Abu Bakr al-Nabulisi. When they grabbed him, he said, the first day, take him and parade him in the market. Strip him naked and parade him in the market. Then he said, the second day, whip him بِالسِّيَاطِ with a lash. ضَرْبًا شَدِيدًا مُبَرَّحًا. Make sure that the beating that he goes through, that it penetrates through his skin. The third day he said, peel his skin off his body. So he couldn't find anyone to do it. فَجِئَ بِيَهُودِيٍّ. He brought a Jew man and he said to him, do it. And the Jew man said he was reading the Quran. وَهُوَ يَقْرَأُ الْقُرْآنَ. I'm taking his skin off him. And he's reading the Quran. He said, فَأَخَذَتْنِي. The Jew man said, I felt soft in my heart. And what I did was, I can see a man whose skin I'm peeling off. So he said, when I reached his heart, and I was peeling his skin off, and I reached his heart, and I could see the man suffering, to give him a quick death, I stabbed him in the heart. So he dies. So this is who he was. I ask you now a question. Do we leave Al-Khulafa Al-Rashidun, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman and Ali, do we leave their path? And do we take the path of the Khulafa al-Ubaydiyun, those individuals? This is a question a mu'min who wants to enter Jannah, who wants to be distanced from the hellfire, this is a question he asks himself. This action that you're doing, who did you take it from? Did you take it from Al-Khulafa al-Rashidun? Or did you take it from Al-Khulafa al-Ubaydiyun? The Mawlid died after Al-Mu'izz li-Dinillah. And then it got revived again by one of the Ubaydiyun leaders. His name was Al-Hakim bi-Amrillah. He revived it again and he brought it back to Egypt again. Who is he now? Al-Hakimu bi-Amrillah. Al-Hakimu bi-Amrillah. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi says in his Sir, in his Sirah Alam al-Nubala, he says, Al-Hakimu bi-Amrillah al-Ubaydiyu al-Misriyu al-Rafidiyu bal-Ismailiyu al-Zindiqu al-Mudda'i al-Rububiyya. Dhahabi says in his Sirah Alam al-Nubala. He says, he's the Hakim bi-Amrillah. He's an Ubaydi. He's an Egyptian. He's Rafidi. Rather, he said, he's not just Rafidi. He's an Ismaili. Al-Zindiq, he's a heretic. Al-Mudda'i, he claimed Rububiyya. He claimed that he's Rabb. Allah is me, he said. And then he said, وَكَانَ الشَّيْطَانًا مَرِيدًا جَبَّارًا عَنِيدًا كَثِيرَ التَّلَوُّنْ سَفَّاكًا لِلدِّمَاءِ خَبِيثًا النِّحْلَةِ عَظِيمَ الْمَكْرِ جَوَّادًا مُمْدَحٍ لَهُ شَأْنٌ عَجِيبٌ وَنَبَأٌ غَرِيبٌ كَانَ فِرْعَوْنَ زَمَانِهِ يَخْتَرِعُ كُلَّ وَقْتٍ أَحْكَامًا يَلْزَمُ الرَّعِيَّةَ بِهَا أَمَرَ بِسَبِّ الصَّحَابَةِ وَبِكِتَابَةِ ذَلِكَ عَلَى أَبْوَابِ الْمَسَاجِدِ وَالشَّوَارِعِ وَأَمَرَ عُمَّالَهُ بِالسَّبِّ وَبِقَتْلِ الْكِلَابِ. He said about him, he's a shaytan marid, stubborn, hard-headed shaytan. كثير التلون, a man who had split personalities. سفاكا للدماء, spilt blood so much. خبيث النحلة, filthy belief. عظيم المكر, deceptive individual. He said له شأن عجيب, his affairs was fascinating. نبأ غريب, shocking stories come to you regarding him. كان فرعون زماني. Is there any description worse than somebody being called فرعون? He said he was the فرعون of his time. يخترع كل وقت, every time he will make أحكاما, he will make up legislations. يلزم الرعية بها, he forces the people to follow that legislation he made. أما he commanded بسب الصحابة, he said the صحابة should be insulted. وبكتابة ذلك على أبواب المساجد, and he said that should be written on the insulting of the companions. He said it should be written on the walls of the masajid. He said write on the wall, and also on the road. He said write it on the walls, the insulting of the companions. وأمر عماله, and he commanded his workers بالسب to insult. And what he also commanded was وبقتل الكلاب. He said the dogs have to be also killed in Egypt. What did the dogs do? وأبطل, and then what did he also do? The شعير, I don't know what شعير is in English. The شعير, the Arabs used to make juices out of it. He prevented them from it. ملوخية, I don't know what is in English. It's a green thing that Egyptians love. He also prevented that in Egypt. Even the fish that has skin, he banned it. Any fish that has skin, he banned them. He said they're not allowed to be eaten. And anyone who was caught selling it will be killed. And he became excessive in his doings until Imam al-Dhahabi said, وَقَدْ حُبِّبَ فِي آخِرِ وَقْتِهِ. In his later stages in his life, he started to love al-Uzla, to boycott the people and to be by himself. He would be alone. And he would go on his riding beast, and he would go to the market. Because look what he killed everybody around him. So he became alone, a stranger. He would take his riding beast, and he would come to the market. Would he come alone? La. He come with a big black slave, would come with him. And this is something, it's hard for my tongue to say, but Dhahabi mentions it in his seer. So I'm just going to transmit to you what has been documented in the history. Okay? And Imam al-Dhahabi mentions this in his Sirah Alam al-Nubala. He said he will take this slave, this black man, and he will come to the market, and he will look at if the people are selling what he told them to sell, and if they're doing it. وَبَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ عَبْدٌ ضَخْمٌ فَاجِرٌ. And with him is a big black slave, transgressive wrongdoer. فَمَنْ وَجَبَ عَلَيْهِ تَأْدِيبٌ. Anybody who deserves to be disciplined, who has sold and bought what he was told not to. أَمَرَ الْعَبْدَ. He would command the black slave, أَنْ يُولِجَ فِيهِ, to rape him in the market. وَالْمَفْعُولَ يَسِيحُ. And the one that it's being done to is screaming. Dhahabi mentions this. Wallah, he mentions it in Sirah Alam al-Nubala. And Dhahabi went on to another stage. He said, وَأَنْشَأَ دَارًا. He made a building. And he placed inside it قُيُودًا وَأَغْلَالًا. He placed chains inside it. وَجَعَلَ لَهَا سَبْعَةَ أَبْوَابٍ. And he made 7 doors for it. And he called it Jahannam. Anybody who he became angry with, he would throw him into this place. And anybody who he felt that deserved discipline, he would take them there. his people, they venerated him as he told them to do so. And so they used to call him Ya Wahid, Ya Ahad, Ya Muhyi, Ya Mumit. That's what they refer to him. Now you've come to realize that these are the people who made the Mawlid. And this is where it came from. Are you with me, brothers? These are the individuals. Your iman is, am I going to leave a tariqah of the Prophet and his companions? And am I going to take a people who Dhahabi and Ibn Kathir and others are calling them Shaytan and Anid and Jabbar and Fir'aun and Zamani? You choose. But the people, Ya Ikhwa, they responded. The other party. What they said was, la. The Fatimiyun didn't start it. They didn't. And this, in the scholars, they call this, they are trying to remove the wasmatu ar. What are they trying to remove? The harsh criticism. They can see the history in front of us and what these people are like. So how did they run away from it? They ran away by saying, no. Malikul Mudaffar, who is the leader of Irbil, he's the first person who started it. And Irbil is, brothers, it's a place in what? It's in Iraq, and it's not far from Mosul. It's the place where the Kurdish live. The response to this, number one, is that's not the case. Because Malikul Mudaffar, he himself, in Irbil, before him it was started. As Imam Abu Shamit al-Maqdisi mentions in his kitab, Al-Ba'ithu ala Inkari al-Bida'i wal-Hawadith. And by the way, Abu Shama is one of the scholars who celebrate the birthday of the Prophet. He mentions that the king, Malik al-Mudaffar, he took it from a man by the name of Umar ibn Muhammad al-Mulla. And Sibt ibn al-Jawzi, in his kitab, Mir'atu al-Zaman fi Tawarikh al-A'yan, 8th volume, page 310, he says that the Malik al-Mudaffar, Malik al-Mudaffar, he took it from the Fatimiyin. Because when time was Malik al-Mudaffar, he's the 7th century. And when is the Fatimiyin? 4th century. Are you with me, brothers? We're saying it's at least close to the Prophet's time, right? We are bringing it closer by saying the Fatimiyin are 4th century. You're pushing it even further by saying it's what? 7th century. You're making it even further from the Prophet ﷺ. Hafidh ibn Kathir in Bidayah wa Nihayah, he mentions that Malik al-Mudaffar took it from who? The Fatimiyin. He mentions the Kitab al-Bidayah wa Nihayah. Even if, okay, the Fatimiyin didn't do it. And we take that Malik al-Mudaffar took it. وَلَوْ سَلَّمْنَا لَكُمْ جَدَلًا. We take it for argument's sake. Isn't this a recognition on your side that this is an innovation? That this started 7 centuries after the Prophet's death, alayhi salatu wasalam? Does this make it more easier for you? Does it make it easier? Why are you running away from saying that the Fatimiyin started it? It's because of their what? Biography, right? But let's look at Malik Mudaffar, his biography. Is it a good biography? Is he a noble person? For them to take him as a role model as well? Yaqut al-Hamawi in his kitab Mu'jam al-Buldan, first volume, page 167, he says, وَطِبَاعُ هَذَا الْأَمِيرِ. The nature of this man, Malik Mudaffar, is مُخْتَلِفَةٌ مُتَبَادَّةٌ. He's got split personality. Do they call it bipolar? Yeah, he's got it. Split personality. فَإِنَّهُ كَثِيرُ الظُّلْمِ. He's very oppressive. عَسُوفٌ بِالرَّعِيَّةِ رَاغِبٌ فِي أَخْذِ الْأَمْوَالِ مِنْ غَيْرِ وَجْهِهَا. He takes the people's wealth unjustly. وَهُوَ مَعَ ذَلِكَ. But even then, he robs the money, he steals the money from the people, but even then, وَهُوَ مَعَ ذَلِكَ مُتَفَضِّلٌ عَلَى الْفُقَرَاءِ. And some of the copies I took it from, it says عَلَى الْقُرَاءِ. He would give to the fuqara, those who are in need, and he would also give to the qurra. He was a person who gave. The money he robbed from the people, he would give it to the fuqara and the qurra. كثير الصدقات. His sadaqah was a lot. على الغرباء, on the strangers. يسير الأموال الجمة الوافرة يستفك بها الأسارة من أيدي الكفار. He would go, take that money and he would go to the disbelievers and he would say, here, take this money, give us the captives and the Muslims that you have. He would do that. وفي ذلك, and his example is the poet, what he said. يقوت الحموي saying this. The example of Malik al-Mudaffar is in this one line of poetry, which is كساعية للخير من كسب فرجها لك الويل لا تزني ولا تتصدقي. A woman who goes out and she does prostitution, she takes money from the prostitution and then she gives sadaqah from it. The poet said, كَسَعِيَةِ لِلْخَيْرِ, like the woman who is going towards good, مِنْ كَسْبِ فَرْجِهَا, from the earnings that she gets from her private part. لَكِ الْوَيْلُ, destruction be to you. لَا تَزْنِي, don't do zina, وَلَا تَتَصَدَّقِ, don't give صدقة. صح؟ So the king, the money that you robbed from the people, then to give it a sadaqah. Don't rob the people's money and don't give sadaqah. So this is his personality. It's not like he was a noble individual himself. I'm going to now, inshallah ta'ala, read you some of the ulama. I've read some. I'm going to add more scholars who've admitted, and they are the ones who celebrated. I'm only going to mention those who celebrate the Prophet's birthday, admitting that this is a what? Newly introduced matter. Suyuti, he's from those who permitted celebrating. In his kitab, Husn al-Maqsad, he says, أول من أحدث فعل ذلك, the first people who started the celebration of the Prophet's birthday is صاحب إرب الملك المظفر. ملك المظفر is the one who started it. We responded to that. We'll take it for the sake of argument. 7 centuries after the Prophet is started. Muhammad Alawi al-Maliki is also from those who celebrated. He said, فَالِاحْتِفَالُ بِالْمَوْلِدِ, celebrating the Prophet's birthday, وَإِن لَمْ يَكُنْ فِي أَهْدِي, even though it was not at the time of the Prophet, فَهُوَ بِدْعَةٌ, it's an innovation, وَلَكِنَّهُ حَسَنَةٌ, it's a good bid'ah. الإمام أبو شامة المقدسي, he says, وَمِنْ أَحْسَنِ مَبْتُدِعَ فِي زَمَانِنَا, one of the good innovations that have been started at our time, is مَا كَانَ بِمَدِينَةِ إِرْبِلْ جَبَرَهَا اللَّهُ تَعَالَى كُلَّ عَامٍ فِي الْيَوْمِ الْمُوَافِقِ لِيَوْمِ مَوْلِدِ النَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم, is the celebrating of the Prophet's birthday, من الصدقات, the sadaqah that the people give, and وَإِظْهَارِ زِينَةِ وَالسُّرُورِ, and the people bringing out their beauties and dressing up. The question now is, there are a group of scholars who are saying don't celebrate the Prophet's birthday. And we have a group of scholars saying, celebrate it, صح? We're trying to be biased, right? Brothers, fair. Yeah? A few said it. We'll just say some scholars said it. And yeah? Some. We'll make it easy. What do we now need to do? النُجْرِيَهُ الْمُحَاكَمَةِ, we have to judge between the two. بَيْنَ الْمُحْتَفِلِينَ, those who are celebrating the Prophet's birthday, and the مُنْكِرِينَ, صح, we have to judge between the two of them. صح. What did Allah say in the Quran when two parties of people differ? What did he say? He said, فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ, if you dispute one another in a matter, what do we do? فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ, if you believe in Allah and the Day of Judgment, where do we bring it back to? The Quran. We take it back to the Sunnah. Allah says, وَمَا اخْتَلَفْتُمْ فِيهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فَحُكْمُهُ فَحُكْمُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ. You do not differ on a matter, and you do not disagree one another in a matter, except the ruling is with who? Is with Allah. Now let's look at what the Quran and the Sunnah mention regarding this issue. The religion stands on two pillars. الدينُ مبني على أصلين. The religion stands on two pillars. Are you with me, brothers? The first one is ألا يعبد إلا الله, that no one should be worshipped except who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وحده لا شريك له, and that we should not associate partners with him. Very good. What is the second thing? ألا يعبد الله إلا بما شرع. ألا يعبد الله, that we do not worship Allah إلا بما شرع. We worship Allah based on what He legislated. Sahih? Are we all together, brothers? Allah legislates it through the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So that's how it's legislated. Are you with me, brothers? Those are the two pillars the religion stands on. Let's look at Mawlid, if it meets the criteria of the conditions of a righteous deed being accepted. Because those people who are screaming in the Mawlid and crying and shaking, the question is, are they not trying to do a righteous action? Isn't that what they want from this? So we're asking ourselves, these are the two pillars in which a righteous deed stands on. Are you there, brothers? Does Mawlid fulfill these two conditions? Does it fulfill one condition? Huh? Which one does it fulfill? Which is sincerity, right? Even that one is a question today. وَإِنَّ مِنْ جُودِكَ الدُّنْيَا وَضَرَّتَهَا وَمِنْ عُلُومِكَ عِلْمَ اللَّوْحِ وَالْقَلَمِ, when they come and they read that in their burda, the Mawlid book, huh? From your knowledge, Busiri, what he says, وَإِنَّ مِنْ جُودِكَ الدُّنْيَا وَضَرَّتَهَا, from your knowledge, Muhammad, because they praise the Prophet, right? And when they praise him, what do? They go overboard. They give Allah's rights to the Prophet, عليه الصلاة والسلام. Did they not? They put the chair for the Prophet there. So the first one itself is missing there. Is it not? It is. And then what's also missing? In accordance to the? In accordance to the Kitab and the Sunnah. Is this something Abu Bakr and the Prophet ﷺ did? They admitted this. They said, Naam, no, he didn't do it. La Abu Bakr did it, wala Umar, wala Uthman. And then now we know the party of scholars who said it is haram are right. There are two things that every action, whether it should be accepted, it stands on these two pillars. This is basic. There's one ayah that summarizes these two pillars. What is it? فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُوا لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ Anyone who hopes to meet his Lord by entering paradise, by being forgiven for his sins. فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُوا لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا Come with righteous deeds, which is what following the Prophet ﷺ. وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةَ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا And do not associate partners with Allah. Those are two pillars. Is it not? It's the last ayah of Surah Al-Kahf. You read it every Friday, right? Very good. Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, he said, فَإِنَّ لِلْعَمَلِ الْمُتَقَبَّلِ شَرْطَيْنِ The action which is accepted has two conditions. أَحَدُهُمَا, the first one is, أَن يَكُونَ خَالِصًا لِلَّهِ وَحْدًا It's sincerely for Allah alone. وَالْآخَرُ, the second is, أَن يَكُونَ صَوَابًا مُوَافِقًا لِلشَّرِيعَةِ The second one is, it is correct and it's in accordance to the Sharia. فَمَتَى كَانَ خَالِصًا If an action is done with sincerity, وَلَمْ يَكُنْ صَوَابًا And it is not done based on the Prophet ﷺ doing it, لَمْ يُتَقَبَّلْ It will not be accepted. However much you cry. Now we ask ourselves a question. Is this religion finished or is it not? Is Islam finished? Yeah? Is it complete? Is it complete? Did the Mawlid, was it added into the religion before it got completed or after? Yeah? It got added into the religion? We don't want anything after the religion. It's complete already. Allah said in the Quran, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ Today I have finished and completed your religion for you. الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمْ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا That day when that ayah came down, what was not a religion will not be a religion today. When the Prophet was alive, what was not a religion at that time will not turn out to be a religion after. Look at this, wallahi. This hadith by itself is enough to just prove the impermissibility of Mawlid. What is it? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Tabarani narrated the hadith bin hadith Abi Dhar, that the Prophet said, مَا بَقِيَ شَيْءٌ Nothing remains. You know what the word مَا بَقِيَ The word مَا is what? Nafyun. It's a negation. مَا بَقِيَ شَيْءٌ شَيْءٌ is a nakiratu fi siyaqin nafyi tufidul umum. It's the qa'id according to the scholars. If an indefinite word comes into the context of a negation, it shows generalization. Nothing whatsoever remains. Wallahi, not small or not large. Nothing remains. يُقَرِّبُ مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ That will bring you close to Jannah. وَيُبَاعِدُ مِنَ النَّارِ And will distance you from the hellfire. إِلَّا وَقَدْ بُيِّنَ لَكُمْ Except it was clarified to you. Allahu Akbar. There's nothing that will take you close to Jannah. The Prophet is saying this to you. There's nothing that will get you closer to Jannah and will distance you from the hellfire except you are told. Except you are? Except you. That hadith is enough to say to us, if this act, the celebrating the Prophet's birthday, is an act that will get us closer to Jannah, then it had to have been told to us. And if it's going to distance us from the hellfire, then it has to be something that the Prophet told us. Are you with me, brothers? It's very important. And Imam Malik said, "Man ibtada'a fil Islam bid'ah." Anyone who innovates in the religion and innovation, yaraha hasana. He sees it to be good. Allahu Akbar. Ask these people, they'll say, good, bid'ah hasana. Imam Malik is saying, anyone who innovates a matter into the religion, he sees that to be good. He sees it to be good. Faqad za'ama. This person has claimed, anna Muhammadan, that the Prophet, khana al-risala, the Prophet has deceived this message. Why? Because it was his job to convey. And you're saying, look, you're saying, Mawlid is an act that will bring you closer to Jannah. Isn't that what they say? And you're saying the Prophet didn't do it, nor did he talk about it, nor did he tell anyone. Are you with me? So there was a path to Jannah. There was a path to go to Jannah, and a path that would distance you from the hellfire. and the Prophet didn't do his job. He withheld that information. He deceived the Ummah from it. That's what you're saying. You're not saying it bilisan al maqal. You're not uttering it. Your actions are. Are you with me, brothers? You're saying, I know a path. I know a path that if I take, it will take me to Jannah and it will distance me from the hellfire. And the Prophet ﷺ didn't explain it. Then Imam Malik recited the ayah, Al-Yawma akmaltu lakum deenakum. And then he said a qa'idah, a principle every person of the Sunnah should hold on to, which he said, فَمَا لَمْ يَكُنْ يَوْمَئِذٍ دِينًا. What wasn't a religion that day? فَلَا يَكُونُ الْيَوْمَ دِينًا. It will not be a religion today. Allah said in an ayah, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ. Be cautious of those who are opposing the Prophet's what? Opposing the Prophet's affairs. The person who's celebrating something that the Prophet did not celebrate, what's going to happen to him? Is he opposing the Prophet or is he in accordance to the Prophet? So let alone him receiving reward for celebrating the Mawlid, what is he taking from the Mawlid? He's taking punishment for it. فَلْيَحَذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِي أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةً أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. Fitna is going to happen to them or a severe punishment the day of judgment. ولذلك this ayah, Al-Imam Malik rahimahullah, a story is mentioned that a man came to him and he said to Imam Malik rahimahullah, Ya Aba Abdullah, min ayna uhrim? Ya Aba Abdullah, Imam Malik, where should I wear my ihram from? And Imam Malik is in Medina. He said to him, go to Dhil Hulayfa, where the miqat of the people of Medina. Min haythu ahrama Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the place where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did his ihram from. The man said, inni uridu an uhrima min al-masjid. I want to do ihram from the masjid. I don't want to go to the miqat. I want to start it earlier. Extra points. Inshallah, I want to put more effort in. So I want to start from the masjid. Imam Malik said, la taf'al, don't do that. قال then he said, inni uridu an uhrima min al-masjid min indi al-qabr. I want to do my ihram in the masjid next to the Prophet's grave. Imam Malik said, la taf'al, don't do that. فإني أخشى عليك الفتنة. I fear for you fitna. I fear fitna for you. The man said, وَأَيُّ فِتْنَةٍ فِي هَذَا. What fitna is in that? إِنَّمَا هِيَ أَمْيَال. It's only a mileage, miles. أَزِيدُهَا. I'm just going to add extra miles on it. It's not a big difference. I'm still in Medina. Dhil Hulayfa and what? The Prophet's masjid. It's just a couple of miles. What fitna do you fear for me? Then Imam Malik said, وَأَيُّ فِتْنَةٍ. What fitna is greater min antarad, for you to see annaka sabaqta ila fadila, that you have hastened to a good, qassara anha Rasulullah, the Prophet was deficient in. That the Prophet was deficient in. Inni sami'tu Allah yaqulu. And then Imam Malik said, I heard Allah say, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةً أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. Rather, brothers and sisters, love that you have for the Prophet and love you have for Allah. If you go wrong in what you're doing, you get punished for it, let alone get rewarded for it. It's not enough to say, I love Allah, I love the Messenger. Are you with me? Because love is a righteous deed. And the Sharia will tell you to how you should come with that righteous deed. Venerating and glorifying the Prophet is a righteous deed. The Sharia is going to tell you how to glorify him and venerate him. You don't make that up. Are you with me, brothers? Qa'idah, these things you need to memorize. Look at the three men who loved the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they came and they visited his house. And they asked the wives of the Prophet, how's the Prophet's prayer like? They love him. And when they were told that he sleeps, he eats, he fasts, he breaks his fast, he sleeps and he eats, and he marries women. Each one said the opposite. I'm going to never sleep, one said. I'm going to be awake. Another one said, I will fast and I will never break my fast. Another one said, I will never get married to women. These men are trying to do extra work. Did they get rewarded for it? What did he say to them? I get married. I also sleep and I eat, wake up. I eat and I break my fast. I fast and I break my fast. And then the Prophet said, فَمَنْ رَغِبَ عَنْ سُنَّتِي فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي. Anyone who shows passion towards other than my sunnah is not from amongst me. These men, they did this out of love. Did they not? Wasn't it love what drove them? Was it accepted from them? It's not enough. It is not. ولذلك some people today who are the Sahabas, even when they were doing extra things and the Prophet sometimes would correct them and say, no, don't do this, don't do this, they were doing at least the wajibat. Some of these people are running around today saying, let's celebrate the Prophet's birthday, let's celebrate the Prophet's birthday. Some of them, I know them, لا يصلون. They don't pray Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, they don't pray Salah. They don't pray Salah. And he says, you Wahhabis don't love the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Ajeeb. You don't pray Dhuhr, Akhi. ولا Asr, ولا Maghrib, ولا Isha, ولا... And the only time that you love the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is when he's born, this is Wahyu Shaytan. This is what? It's a wahyu shaytan. Shaytan is sending revelation on you. I'm going to, inshallah ta'ala, conclude with the last point, bi'idhnillah al-kareem. Al-Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah. There's a thing I really want to show you. Al-Imam al-Bukhari in Kitab al-Hajj. Bukhari, rahimahullah, in Kitab al-Hajj. He does a chapter, he chapter. He called it Babu. Man lam yastalib illa ruknayn al-yamaniyayn. I want you to ponder here. This chapter, he called it the chapter. مَنْ لَمْ يَسْتَلِمْ, the person who does not touch except the two Yemeni corners. One is the black stone and one is the Yemeni corner. Okay? They face towards Yemen. Are you with me? So he chaptered a chapter where he says not touching the Kaaba except the Yemeni corner and the black stone. So he said the Kaaba is four sides, right? The Prophet ﷺ, there's two sides that face towards Yemen. They're called Yamaniyain. And there's two sides that face towards Sham. It's called Shamiyain. Together? Are we all together with that?
Yes.
We all understand. Bukhari chaptered in his Sahih. And the ulama, they say, Fiqh al-Bukhari. The Bukhari's fiqh is in his what? His tarajum, his chapterings. So these two sides, the Prophet used to touch. Like Abdullah ibn Umar, Bukhari, straight away after he brings Kitab al-Hajj, Babu man lam yastalib illa ruknayn al-yamaniyayn, straight after that he brings his sanad until Abdullah ibn Umar. And that Abdullah ibn Umar said, lam ara an-nabiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yastalimu min al-bayti illa ruknayn al-yamaniyayn. Abdullah ibn Umar said, I never saw the Prophet touch except the two sides, which is the Yemeni corner and the black stone. I only saw him touch those two. Are you with me, brothers? Yarhamukallah. Are we all together on that? So, Abdullah ibn Abbas, he saw Muawiyah, the faqih of this ummah, Abdullah ibn Umar. Abdullah ibn Abbas also said about Muawiyah, huwa min afqahi sahabati Rasulillah. He's from the fuqaha of the companions. Abdullah ibn Abbas said this about Muawiyah. But he saw Muawiyah from far. What was he doing? Touching four sides of the Kaaba. When he saw him, Bukhari brings it. عن أبي الشعثاء أنه قال ومن يتقي شيئا من البيت وكان معاوية يستلم الأركان. That Muawiyah would touch the four sides. Abdullah ibn Abbas went to him and he said to him, pay attention. Why do you touch the four? Now I want you guys to think before we move on the discussion. The Prophet did not say you can't touch the other two sides. Think here. Abdullah ibn Umar only said that I did not see the Prophet touch the other two. His proof here is the fact the Prophet left it. Abdullah ibn Umar. Ibn Abbas's fiqh is that the Prophet left this action of touching the other two sides. There's no narration where the Prophet says, you only touch the two Yemeni corner and the black stone. He didn't say that. They just saw him touch these two sides. So what they took from that, you can't touch the other two because he didn't touch it. He left it. The leaving of the Prophet is their proof. Are we all together? So he came to Ibn Umar, Ibn Abbas came to Muawiyah after seeing him touch the four sides. And then he said to him, why is it that I see you touch the four sides? Look at Muawiyah's response. Muawiyah says, لَيْسَ شَيْءٌ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ مَهْجُورًا. The house, the Kaaba, there's not a place where we boycott. Take that answer today and ask those people, why do you celebrate the Prophet's birthday? What do they say to you? The Prophet ﷺ is a person we love. We can't leave him. Same argument? Same. Does it not resemble each other? Good. Look what Ibn Abbas said to Muawiyah straight away. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا. In the Prophet ﷺ for you is a great example. What did Muawiyah say? He didn't say you hate the Kaaba. You have something in your heart towards the Kaaba. Did he say that? No, he said, Sadaqta. You've told the truth. And Muawiyah never used to touch the other two sides. He left it. Pay attention. Are we together? Let's look at what Hafidh ibn Hajar brings in Fath al-Bari. Are we all together, brothers? Hafidh brings a powerful statement. Who does he transmit it from? Al-Imam al-Shafi'i. Shafi'i says the statement of Muawiyah, which is Laysa shay'un min al-bayti mahjuran, that there is nothing in the house of Allah that we boycott and we leave and we abandon. Shafi'i said بِأَنَّا لَمْ نَدَعْ إِسْتِلَامَهَا, we did not leave off touching the other two sides. The other two sides, which are the Shamiyain. We haven't stopped from touching those two sides حَجْرًا لِلْبَيْتِ, because we're boycotting the house. No. وَكَيْفَ يَهْجُرُ, how is it that we're boycotting it? وَهُوَ يَطُوفُ بِهِ, when we're doing tawaf around it. وَلَكِنَّا but نَتَّبِعُ السُّنَّةَ فِعْلًا وَتَرْكًا, but the reason why we left this is we are following the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. What he did we do, and what he left we leave. We have not chosen to not celebrate the Prophet's birthday because the response is وَلَكِنَّا نَتَّبِعُ السُّنَّةَ فِعْلًا وَتَرْكًا. Are you with me, brothers? I conclude there, inshallah ta'ala. Anything which I have said that might have been wrong, incorrect, mistake, error, is from me, a shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.